everyone knows that Taiwanese food is not Chinese food, and it's more than night market dishes. So to answer the question, what is Taiwanese food then? I'm very excited to have our panel of very special guests tonight. Of course, we have Clarissa Wei, the author of the James Beard Award nominated cookbook, but I think more importantly, her work has really introduced a lot of folks out here in the States to a culture that maybe they're hoping to get closer to or something that they wish to learn more about. So let's give a very, very warm Bay Area welcome to Clarissa Wei.
Hi, thank you so much for being here. It's really cool to meet fans of the book in real life because I've just been stuck in Taiwan for the last 9 months, so this is really exciting.
Woohoo! We're excited too!
And joining Clarissa is Chef Tony Tung, the owner and executive chef of Good To Eat Dumplings.
We're really, really happy to have Clarissa tonight, and they can sit down here and we can talking together about what is Taiwanese food. So I'm so excited. Thank you.
And rounding out the group is Angie Lin, who's a sake and wine sommelier, but also in charge of hospitality here at Good To Eat.
Nice to meet you all. That I have been chatting with a majority of you on our floor on Taiwanese food and culture, and I'm just so excited that we have such a panel here today that we can talk about this in even more in-depth way.
I've been told that we're not loud enough, so excuse me, one turning some knobs. All right, so honestly, I've given this a lot of thoughts, like how are we going to define Taiwanese food? So I don't really have a good answer, but I think we can start by talking about the influence it's had. And I think this is kind of something unique to Taiwan as like a geographic location. So maybe I'll toss it over to Clarissa first. So how would we, if we were trying to describe Taiwanese food through its influence, how would you go about that?
Yeah, so I get this question a lot, especially, you know, there's a lot of foreign correspondents in Taiwan now covering the potential war, and they're like, how do you describe Taiwanese food? And I just say Taiwanese food is the food that we people in Taiwan eat, and they are really disappointed. And when I was writing my book, I also really kind of tried to figure that out, and what I found out was that there are all of these influences, and that influences are what makes up Taiwanese food. So, you know, the first wave is in the 18th century, the Minnan people from the Fujian province of China, and I think this is kind of where people get stuck, and correct me if I'm wrong, when I was growing up, you know, people were like, oh, your family came from China, from Minnan, from Fujian. But when I was doing this book, I realized that was 200 years ago. That was when the United States of America was founded. Like, people do not in America say, oh, I'm English, or, you know, my family came from the Mayflower, and identify with the UK. But why is it that we as Taiwanese people, if we have ancestors that came over from China at that time, were conflated with China? And then after that, the Japanese era, and then Japanese to me is really fascinating because they created all of our pantry items. So the way that soy there's a lot of different types of soy sauce styles, but a lot of the soy sauce styles, rice wine, rice vinegar, that's made in the Japanese style. And then we have post 1949, after the Chinese Civil War, the KMT. And I think a lot of Taiwanese Americans really resonate with that type of food. You know, that's the beef noodle soup, the scallion pancakes. And then this is something that most people don't really know all that much, but then the American influence, and you guys probably grew up in Taiwan when that was the heaviest. So That's, you know, the night market steaks. In Taiwan, we actually eat hamburgers for breakfast. The popcorn chicken, the chicken cutlet, that's really American influence. Did you guys know that 90% of all wheat in Taiwan is imported from America and came to America because of a Cold War policy? Like, so we have a lot of American influence. And then the last one that I didn't write in my book, but is very relevant into Taiwan today, is we have a Southeast Asian influence as well. 80% of all immigrants in Taiwan who are naturalized are Southeast Asian. So that those are the main categories, I would say, of modern Taiwanese food.
For Tony and Angie, anything you guys would like to add, having kind of, you know, grown up in the in Taiwan and then coming to the United States?
Yeah, so both Tony and myself, we were born and raised from Taiwan. That so if we put this in the like time horizon perspective, that so well, I guess we have to disclose our age. That we were born around 1979, 1978. So it's really interesting that while nowadays that people often say that, oh, are you Taiwanese, or you are from China? So-called that if we use Mandarin, the so-called 外省人 and the 本省人, that so actually from our growing up experience, we are fully aware of these two type of the identity, but it is very typical at the generation of us that we embrace these two identity together. So it's not that we are like, oh, I'm Taiwanese, you are so actually it's very, very typical that people already like embrace all of these different elements and enjoy everything. Everyone enjoy the night market. Everyone enjoy the cuisine from the Taiwan, the traditional Taiwanese, and everyone also enjoy the cuisine from China and also from America. So I would say we grew up. I would say it's a really that really multi-culture and to a degree that we train our palate as like very diverse. So one common conversation we have a lot of do you like rice more or do you like noodle more? Actually, for most of people, that so it's really that after I eat the rice for a couple of days, I miss noodle. So after I have noodle for a couple of days, I miss rice. It's very, very difficult. Yeah. So for us, it's really like between two of us, I myself, I came from a family like my father's side is 外省人. So immigrant from China with Chiang Kai-shek, my mother's side is Taiwanese. And Chef Tony's family is half Taiwanese.
My mother is the 原住民.
Yeah.
Original Taiwanese.
Yeah. Indigenous. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. And then my father is Taiwanese.
Yeah. So I would say that at our generation, so it is very typical for us that to start to embrace all of this diversity and start to explore the flavor of our own.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think when the people from the KMT came over in the beginning, there was a lot of segregation. Mm-hmm. So you guys described it as 外省人, those are the mainlanders, mm-hmm. and then 本省人, the Taiwanese. We in Taiwan also refer to them as sweet potato or taro, mm-hmm. which I think is really cute. So sweet potato are the people who have been there for a long time, the Taiwanese, and the taro are the new immigrants. And then if you're like Angie, you would be a Olan Haijing, you would be a sweet potato taro.
I'm sweet potato taro, yes.
So that's like my parents' generation. I remember being a kid, they'd be like, oh, that's sweet potato taro, or like, that taro. But now, like, the kids these days in Taiwan, no one's calling each other a sweet potato or a taro anymore. We're all kind of integrated. And mm-hmm. what's cool is that Taiwan is, you know, 95%, you know, Han Chinese ethnicity, but I think it's an incredible melting pot. And just depending on when your family immigrated to Taiwan, you have completely different, diverse food traditions. So people like Angie's family probably eat very differently than like my family or Tony's family.
Yeah, it's really different. Yeah. So when I grew up, so I just echo from back to you when you said Japanese in Taiwan, so we know a lot of soy sauce or rice vinegar or rice something. Beginning Taiwan, we have our own soy sauce, but it's black bean, not soy bean. So for me, traditional flavor soy sauce, if I smell the soy sauce, I can just know, oh, this Taiwanese soy sauce, not soy bean paste. So for me, Taiwanese food is really interesting because including a lot of ingredient is really different. People to come into Taiwanese island, they will bring different things in this island. But this island people is really cute and really tolerant.
Tolerant? Inclusive?
Yeah.
Inclusive.
So they really good. They can take everything they want and they just recreate. So I think that's really interesting. Yeah, really.
So if I were to kind of go a step further with this very inclusive kind of attitude and the fact that having different immigration wave coming to Taiwan, what does that do to the flavor profile of Taiwanese food?
So generally, if I had to describe Taiwanese food, and I feel it very distinctly now that I'm in America, when I landed in Chicago, I was like, oh my gosh, everything's so salty and like really intense. But our flavor profile is a bit sweeter, but actually just more mild, you know? So like I was interviewing a Taiwanese Asian bakery in Chicago, and they had actually had chefs from Taiwan open their bakery, and I was just like, hey chefs, like tell me what's it like over here? And they're like, let me tell you, Americans like it really sweet and really strong. So that was kind of a eureka moment, even though I think Taiwanese food is really sweet, maybe Americans are even sweeter. So the word in Chinese is just the biao dan, like more plain. And in terms of protein, it's mostly pork and seafood. We have beef now, but beef does not traditional. Beef is very, very new in Taiwan. Up until the 1960s, it was taboo to eat beef. You guys probably have better stories.
Eat, yeah, when you was younger, my grandma said you cannot eat the beef because cows help you to
So eating beef will
it's walking.
Bad luck.
Yeah, it's bad luck.
Yeah, I think I read that if you ate beef, it was a straight ticket to hell or something.
That's brutal. But yes. Yes, similar idea.
I forgot the question. Sorry.
Oh, no, that's fine. I was talking about the flavor profile. So you mentioned how it's lighter.
Yeah, it's just quite mild. That's the best.
Yeah, I think that's easy. Yeah, when I start cooking here, this is one of the problem we got because when people try our food first, will be thinking, can I have more salt? Can I have more soy sauce? And then I also, why you need that? Which item dish you need? Or they tell me, your noodle or my fried chicken. I say, what? Why you need that? So it's already salty enough for me. Yeah, so I really want to say that Taiwanese food is not really salty or greasy because Taiwan really realized and really proud how we use the ingredient to build the food, the different layer including aroma, texture, and then the saltiness, sour, sweet, all from the natural ingredient. So we really rely on sun and the wind and the time to get the all ingredient come out so we can cook in that. So when I heard, oh, I need more salt, I need more soy sauce, I think maybe you just go in the wrong restaurant. So I can give you salt, no problem, but I will already tell you this dish need like this flavor. Yeah, so
I love that story because I ran into the exact same problem when I was recipe testing. So all my recipes were developed in Taiwan with a Taiwan Ivy, who's a Taiwanese cooking teacher. And I got recipe testers from all over America and Europe. And when I gave them the recipes, the main feedback was, this is not salty enough. And I really, really struggled because I was like, if I put more salt, it won't taste like what it does in Taiwan. So a lot of the recipes, it's just salt to taste. because that is how it goes. But it's funny, my husband's from Sweden, so he carries around salt in like a film canister. And people think he's like sprinkling drugs everywhere he goes in Taipei, but it really is very prominent. Like the food there is very mild.
I really want to echo back to this point that, so I think this is like so interesting and it's a good point for us to talk more about Taiwanese flavor sensibility. That so yeah, we get this comment a lot, but so from my perspective, that we often struggle with like two perspectives. One is that the misperception of Taiwanese food is just like overall Chinese food. Not to mention that the overall Chinese food today, that unfortunately, a major misconception is Chinese food is fast and casual, salt, sweet, grease. But we all know that that's not all the Chinese food. So that's one thing we need to fight for. That is not only for Taiwanese food, but also for, in general, Asian food, that we hope our customer, or we hope the community can be even more open-minded to try more delicate flavors. So this one. And the second is that the Taiwanese food flavor sensibility is really quite different. That in our tasting menu, we have one soup. That that soup, some customer has been to our tasting menu. So that one soup used like more than 30 ingredients, and we always present that soup, and then I tell customer that actually there's one secret to make this soup so amazing, and I will tell you later. And after all the customer try that soup and say, wow, so good, blah blah blah. And I will share that one secret is that there is absolutely no salt in the soup. And everyone just blown their mind. So that's where we start to explain that actually traditionally Taiwanese food is really use the nature ingredient, some dry ingredient, high treated ingredient, and to layer together to create the umami. So and I can use another example that Tony always I often help to taste things that when she is doing the R&D that she always said that don't conclude the flavor, you need to taste the flavor at the second taste. So the first taste is not count. You need to do it at the second taste. And so last December, she went back to Taiwan to visit a traditional Taiwanese chef. And I was surprised that chef mentioned exactly the same thing. And then I asked why. And he said that because Taiwanese food is all about the layers of the umami. So for the first bite, you might feel it's not enough. But you never taste a dish just with one bite. It's like the full experience, you keep eating it, all the layers like accumulated together, all the umami started to multiply together. That's the flavor, that's the true spirit of the multi-layer flavor and the umami of Taiwanese food.
Yeah, it almost sounds like when the food is not loud, it requires the eater to slow down a little bit and pay attention to what we're eating. I know one thing that I also see a lot is diners will ask for hot sauce, and I feel that's also a very American thing. And you know, there's like chili oil crunch and other things that Tony will make in-house, but even those are not very spicy. But it's also in the absence of those kind of very extreme flavor, people get to really take the time to figure out how it tastes and, you know, how it feels and all that. You know, it's almost like a different kind of approach.
I have a fun fact about spicy food in Taiwan. This is totally irrelevant. But we have the largest collection of chili peppers in the entire world in Taiwan at an institute called the World Vegetable Center. No one eats it in Taiwan. I was interviewing them for the New Yorker, and I was just walking through, and it was like hundreds of different colors and shapes, and I was like freaking out. And then I was asking the researcher, like, do you eat this? And she's like, no, it's too spicy. Like, all the Taiwanese people are like really scared of it. And the reason why they have it in Taiwan is because we don't breed a lot of chili peppers, so there aren't disease and pests. So it's a really good place for vegetable breeding. So yeah, Taiwan has the largest varieties of chili pepper, tomatoes, and mung beans in the entire world, in like a small little middle of nowhere place in Sanhua in Tainan. But like, yeah, the island's just full of random surprises. And it's kind of cool because we are an island of immigrants. We actually sometimes don't, like, chili peppers go really well in our climate, but we don't eat it because people don't have that tradition based on where they came from in China or during those waves of tradition. So it's really fun for me to, like, find these, you know, plants that grow really well in Taiwan, but people are really scared of, and chili pepper is one of those things. Yeah, sorry, that was not relevant to Taiwanese food identity.
All right, so now if I can take it one step further. So we've talked about the influence, talked about the flavor. What can Taiwanese food tell us about its people? You're kind of going the other way around. Like Clarissa, you mentioned how Taiwanese food is what people eat on the island. You know, now we're going through the lens of looking at what the food is and how people eat. What does it tell us about its people?
Yeah, so this is going to sound really cheesy, but I think it just says that people of Taiwan are very diverse. And the reason why I say that this is because I just did a story on the inauguration banquet of Lai Ching-te, the current president. And I was hanging out with the curators who curated that menu, and it was a combination of a fine dining young chef and an old school chef who has been, he cooks like 1980s banquet food. And then a young food writer and then an older food writer. And they kind of thought about this question because the Taiwanese inauguration menu is a reflection of Taiwan today. And they were thinking about it really hard. And they just said every single course has to represent a different segment of Taiwanese society. So they had, you know, the sweet potato people course, the Minnan people, they had Waisenza, the Taro people, they had indigenous, they had Hakka, they had Southeast Asian, and that was their menu, and indigenous also. So it was just cool coming from America where we have so much diversity, and then going to Taiwan where people are like, we also have diversity. And I'm obsessed with inauguration menus. I think it's really interesting because every inauguration menu is a representation of how Taiwan saw itself back then. So Tsai Ing-wen, if you look at her menu, she had Hakka and indigenous. But this, Lai Ching-te, his menu took it another level. And we'll just continue to see this as time goes on.
Right. It was a, which president was it that had the oa hanji for the dessert?
Oh, I don't know.
I think it's Chen Shui-bian.
Chen Shui-bian.
Yeah.
So the one even further back had the sweet potato and taro as a dessert. Again, signifying kind of what Clarissa was saying earlier, the people no longer calling each other by these names. Cause now we've,
yeah, I love, so Chen Shui-bian is the first DPP president, basically the first president outside of the KMT. And before him, all of those menus were what I call ethereal Chinese food. So like shark fin soup, Peking duck, Jiangsu, whatever. And then when he came, it was, you know, Hakka food. He had a lot of Tainan xiao ci, like Tainan snacks. Yeah. Were you guys there when he had his banquet? Do you remember?
Actually, I was lucky enough that my family got invited to Chen Shuibian's state banquet. Yeah, so, and I remember by the time that that was a really exciting moment because at that era that you just feel that it's impossible for those food to be at that occasion, just impossible. So just like you said that, so each state banquet is really representing what is Taiwan right now. So that is really the beginning of that people start to see that our food culture has not only the taro people but the sweet potato people that the food for everyone.
Right, and I think what Angie means by impossible is because the food of the Mainan people that before was kind of looked down upon, which is really interesting because they made up 75% of the population.
Yeah.
But when the KMT came over, even though they only made up 15%, they were the ruling class, so their food really dominated culture. I'm actually curious, when you guys were growing up, like when you guys, did you feel a disconnect between what Taiwanese food was being promoted abroad versus what you guys ate at home? Like, do you feel, like Fu Pei Mei, for example, she was cooking lots of regional Chinese food, but did you guys watch her shows and then go home and be like, I'm not eating any of this?
I think my family, no, we don't look in the Fu Pei Mei, the show to cooking. So my family, because like I said, my father is Taiwanese, so my mother is the Yuanzhumin. So our home cooking is really, I think just really simple, best for the normal people. So that's really home style cooking and just use simple ingredient. And then, but always have the fish, vegetable, chicken, five dish and one soup every night. So every day is different and start breakfast until dinner. So I think the mother is really working so hard. Listen, every day I need to thinking what kind of food I need to cook. So yeah, so my food, yeah, my home is not really taro way, the cooking style. Yeah.
No, I really like Clarissa's question that through your question, I reflect myself that it's really that we didn't distinguish. Fu Pei Mei is she cooked more dish representing dishes from China. That so I feel in general that my experience, my journey of growing up, that it's just like, we keep accepting all the new things that and really didn't distinguish that what's what that so I think that's really representing that how inclusive the Taiwanese people is. But I also have to admit that there's a long period of time that it's true that people, and especially I myself, I actually born and raised from Taipei. So I born from capital city. So my story will be a little bit different from her because she is from Taichung. Yeah, so it is true that there was a period of time that we in general feel that the 外省菜, so the dishes from China is more higher class. So that's I think that's part of the reason why that when I growing up and especially after I start to work with Tony, that I feel I have been rediscovering the beauty of the Taiwanese cuisine. So the more I discover, the more I feel more obsessed about it.
I think one thing is for me is the, because my home, I live in the home next to really close the Jianchun
military village.
Yeah, so I'm really always excited because every day I have $5. Mm-hmm. I can buy anything by myself. So I really like going to buy with the old grandpa only can speak Mandarin. And Mandarin sounds really different from me. So I know he's the Weizen. So I always call Weizen Agong. And then he always making really good mantou, the baobab. It's really Taiwan, the tofu, the very salty fermented tofu. I really love that. So for me, I think that food is really good, but I don't know that's the Weizen. I only know that he the sounds really different, like my family. But I always buy the something that's next by myself. So I think that's really good for me.
So I mean, I obviously grew up in America. I'm from Southern California, but my family's from Tainan. So that's funny. We're like Northern, you're middle, and I'm South. So we are Taiwan. But I would only go to Tainan when I was a kid. So I thought all of Taiwanese food were these like small eats, like oyster omelets, like bawan, mokwe. When I went to Taipei for the first time when I was like 12, I was like, what is this? Like, this is completely different. So it's like we might look the same, but based on where our families are from in Taiwan, our food cultures are quite different. So that's why it's really difficult to define Taiwanese food in one sentence. And the best thing to just say is what people in Taiwan eat.
It almost sounds like the one common thread is no matter the time era or what people brought new ways of eating in, it just gets added to the repertoire. I think that's why sometimes people say, oh yeah, Taiwanese food is the best food. I was like, of course, all these people pass through the island and then they keep the best stuff. That's why it's the best.
But now I'm very happy to see more people, and including this time, the food we call, just represent called Taiwanese banquet food. The banquet food, we call it 半桌. And then I think that for me is really, that's why I want to open a restaurant. And then it's why I'm working so hard to cook in those really old school way, the Taiwanese food, because I really wanted more people to see, to try those flavor, because that's really, for me, it's really classic. And then it's more, I always call this a really humble food, because in that timeline, they don't have very expensive ingredient. They only really humble ingredient, but they use their creative, use their heart. And then, like I said, they use the time and then sun and the wind to make in the all the ingredient can combine and then can cook in the food and then deliver to the neighbor or something. So those food, I think, is really beautiful, and it's not common in Taiwan. Every home can cook in that type of the food, but that's really Taiwanese, because beginning always just chef bring the knife and then go into the village or something. Then all the neighbors will be help. And then if you have bowl, you have a chopsticks, you have a table, everyone will all together and then cooking together and then use the really simple heart and just want to make a really good dish to all, every single one. And then everyone separation in the same thing. So that kind of Taiwan 人情 way for me is real Taiwan. What is Taiwanese food? What is Taiwanese flavor? For me, that is Taiwanese flavor, because those people, how they using the simple heart and then making really good food just for sharing, just for celebration and all together. I think that for me is really wonderful and beautiful. And I miss that, because when I was a child, I always, because I like eating, so my grandma always bring me going to eat. And then, so when I need help, so I'm really happy I can help wash the veggie or clean the table all the time. Then when everything finished, we always have very special food can eat in for everyone, every helper. I think that kind of moment, that kind of vibe, is I really want to recreate here, and then everyone can have chance can eat what is Taiwanese food, not only big noodle, not only chou tofu, not only street food or night market. Taiwan have a lot of food, very, very beautiful, and very elegant. I don't know how to call that, but I hope I can try to cook more food for everyone. So that's, for me, that is Taiwanese food. Yeah.
Yeah, so Chef Tony's style of Taiwanese food, bandol, or the banquet food, is, I actually didn't write about it in the book, which I wish I did. There could be a whole cookbook about it, but I would say it's kind of the oldest form of fine dining in Taiwan, but it's overlooked. So when I used to go to Tainan, you would see people set up these large pink tables next to the temples, and they bring out these portable woks, and all of this is done on the streets, by the way, and you know, it's like sinks that they, I don't know how they do water. How do they deal with the water access?
Even no water, you cannot make that happen.
Yeah, so it's a celebratory thing. So when people got married, they would close off entire blocks. It's like an old school Taiwanese block party. And these chefs would just whip up all of these things on the go. And it's so incredible, and it's really, really fading, even in Taiwan. In Taipei, we rarely see it. I signed up for one last year, but it became really touristy, and the food wasn't that good, and only you can really get it in the South. And I know you've like worked with some chefs who still do it.
He's really wonderful, yeah. So I really want to recall this kind of really traditional on the street or on the temple and the build outside, build a tent. And then you have to set up the kitchen by every equipment by yourself and start 3 a.m. morning.
Yeah.
Then start everything set up and start prepping, cooking, and until noon or dinner, you can have the 100 table or how many table they can celebrate together. Yeah, I really want to, and we have the project, we really want to go back to Taiwan and then take this film and to show the people how they work it. The people are so amazing, really crazy. When I go back, I'm working with them 3 days. I need so tired. It's really great. I already capable working here 12 hours every day, but it's really hard because you are not on the table. Everyone just on the street and then big, I don't know how to call that. And they just watch the veggie by no chair can see.
They're just squatting. Doing the squat. Asian squat,
yeah.
With your own.
All day.
It like looks like a cartoon how big everything is. And the reason why I haven't really written about it or put it in the book is it's really hard to find people to talk to because Tony's probably the youngest person I've ever seen who is interested in this and does it. And it's really cool that you guys have this type of Taiwanese food in America because I can't find this in Taipei and I've tried and it's a dying form of very classical Taiwanese food. So, yeah, I'm jealous. I wish I could eat this all the time.
Yeah, like in some way we're talking about how Taiwan readily accepts new cultures and new ways of eating and new immigration way. And I know like kind of the recent time, Taiwan's now, you know, on the Michelin map, there's a lot more talk about fine dining. To me, there's always a little bit about that is kind of playing into the Western style of fine dining, of that particular definition where, you know, it's like very serious. You know, servers are come and they go away, and it's kind of quiet, and it's very, you know, smaller portions of food usually. But kind of what we're describing here is very different.
Yeah.
We're talking about, you know, in front of the temple, and it's a lot of people, and
yeah.
It's a lot of energy.
Well, there are different waves of fine dining. So during the Japanese era, they had fine dining restaurants, but they, like, the Japanese kind of promoted it as, like, tropical Taiwanese style food. And there's one restaurant in Taipei called Mountain Sea House that still specializes in it. He specifically specializes in 1980s, like, fine dining Taiwanese cuisine. And his chef sort of learned from the Japanese era. But a lot of the dishes are, it seems similar to what you guys do. So, like, the aged radishes, two types of radishes in a soup. So, again, that's what's cool about Taiwan. Well, interesting about Taiwan. All of our different waves of colonization, different formats of fine dining, different formats of street food. And I think because of this, sometimes we're a little bit confused about our food identity, even in Taiwan. And but at the same time, that's why we can have weird things like boba pizza or just like crazy things because people are like, okay, sure, why not, right?
I think Taiwanese, I really want to share one for the Taiwanese fine dining, because everyone knows the fine dining or omakase, usually the portion is really small because they design for the one bite for your taste, right? But in the Taiwan, the banzhou, the banquet, the design original is you have to eat really full, and then when halfway, they already give you the to-go bag. The design is you have to go some food, go home, and then the journey will be until next day, including maybe whole week. Because all crazy, the portion is really huge, not just for you. So when we're doing the tasting menu here, all the comment is, you are so kind, your food, the portion so huge, and then I think this I can eat three more days, you know. But that's not me, that's for Taiwan. Taiwan is how we treat the people, how we want the people eat the food is really happiness, and not only one bite, you can have a lot of bite. Okay, so this is why Taiwan is so, yeah. The food is really cute and really, really, really kind to the people.
I was supposed to check time. I realized that the conversation was so good. I didn't want to interrupt. But I do want to save a little bit of time for Q&A. But before I wrap up, I want to give you folks a chance to share why you folks do what you do. Why Made in Taiwan?
Yeah. So again, I'm Taiwanese American, and I'm a food writer, and I just felt like there was a space to occupy. I've been in Asia for 6 years now, and I just felt like there wasn't a book that fully embodied what Taiwanese food is like in Taiwan today. You know, there's people can talk a lot about Taiwanese-American food or foods from their families, but again, because Taiwanese food changes so fast, it's kind of hard to like capture it, right? And my parents, when they came here, so I think a lot of Taiwanese Americans of my age, when they think of Taiwanese food, they think of Taiwanese food in the 1990s, or like we're sort of stuck in time. And then when I moved to Taiwan, I was like, oh wow, things are really different. So I just really wanted to update it and have this complete piece that represented Taiwan. And I was there, and I had resources to an incredible chef and team who was able to help me capture this moment in time. And I think this book, like, funnily enough, you know, in 10-20 years it will need updating, because how people see Taiwanese food will be different again. Like, our sense of identity is constantly changing, and it's a very dynamic cuisine. Yeah.
Me? Very simple. It's, I really want more people to eat and taste what is Taiwanese food. Not only beef noodle soup or the tofu. So I hope I can cook it more different Taiwanese food. Make more people to know, oh, that when you see the picture, you know, oh, that is Taiwanese food. So I really want just use our small power through the food, and make people eat the food, and then to know, to interesting, want to learn more what is Taiwanese food. And I hope the Taiwanese food can more on the international. Yeah, like the banquet food, this kind of the food is really hard to, like the she said, it's really, even the Taiwan is really hard to find this. If you know someone want to marry, so just as I don't have an HRC that I can go. You know, you only can try this way. And it's, so you cannot just at a restaurant and just go walk in and you want to eat a 100 years old dish or 75 years old dish. It's really hard to find the food. So I really want the people when I asking or anyone asking, any people, what is Taiwanese food? I hope the answer have different, can change. Not only people who don't soup, not only sort of. So that's why I opened a restaurant, and why I use the food to tell the people more about Taiwanese food, the Taiwan, the food behind the food, the history.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm so touched by your answer. For me, it's like really simple that I moved to here at my age of like 20-ish, that so there has been so many years that I feel being Taiwanese, that, well, I have to very embarrassingly to admit this, that I have been feeling that there's nothing to talk about. There's nothing special, not as special as like, we Italian food, blah, 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 blah. We French food, blah, 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 blah. That, so I used to feel this is nothing special. And so, and it's even so hard to mention something like so distinguished or signature dishes. So it's just hard to describe, and to a degree I feel it's not special. But throughout all of these years, that I feel that actually we really need to work on that, put this multicultural cuisine into a narrative in today's dining world. Because at the end of the day, that food keep evolving, food created by people. And Taiwan is the amazing, amazing example that there are so many culture influences. So many people come to Taiwan and they left something, and the people stay on the island, keep accepting new influences and create new synergy of their own. And the pass generation by generation, just out of the love and the care. So that's something that when I start to help Chef Tony to tell the food stories, that's something touched me the most. And the more I discover, the more I feel like I want to share these stories to more people. I want the people from that island to be seen, because they are this type of, they have such a big heart, and this is how they create food. And food is just the, one of the representation. So, yeah.
Yeah, and on that note, I also want to add that politics plays a huge part in how we perceive our food. You know, up until the 90s, we were, for 20-some years, we were under martial law. Taiwan was a dictatorship, and we were told that we were Chinese, and that's why people didn't necessarily value what we were consuming. We were, what was valued was this, concept, this construct that most people weren't eating, this ethereal regional Chinese food. And over the last 30 years, only in the last 30 years have been people have been thinking, okay, what is Taiwanese food? And now we're kind of at this moment where, and I think this recent inauguration banquet is a really good example, where people are like, okay, yeah, the food of Taiwan is representative of our democracy. And people are always like, why do you have to bring politics into it? And I'm like, but politics has such a big part in how we perceive our food, and how our identity constantly changes. So you can't really talk about the whole picture of Taiwanese food without considering the politics and the history of our island.
All right. On that note, we still have some time before we'll wrap up here and go into a book signing, and you all get to meet Clarissa, but I want to see if anybody has any questions you would like to ask the panelists. You guys want to come up and grab the mic, or you want to?
You can say it yourself. Yeah.
Okay. My question is about how class also affects, in addition to the politics with clients. Like, I was at Nanhui in Taizong, which is now the very up-and-coming rich area of Taizong. My mom grew up in Jiaisi, she grew up in Dongsi Town, so it's a very traditional marketplace, and so that's the kind of food I always grew up eating when I went to Taiwan. But it seems like Nanhui has like no Xiaosi Dian, like nothing, and that was so shocking to me, because I was like trying to like find something and there was just nothing to eat there. And so I just wonder like how you have seen that kind of dynamic play out, like maybe in Xin Yi Chu, also in like Taipei, like maybe another rich area where there's no shelter. And then my aunt was telling me that during the pandemic and when the recession was happening, shelter were very affected by that kind of economic influence, and just wondering if like that kind of cuisine is maybe not as popular anymore, or you know, people tell me that young people don't go to like Sichuan to eat anymore, but again, that's what my mom's was eating, so I'm just very curious.
Yeah, So I definitely see that. Oh, so sorry, the question was how class plays a role in cuisine in Taiwan today. And I definitely think small eats or these street food bites are just becoming more rarefied, or people don't value it, because just as society changes in Taiwan, as income levels go up, we're not really valuing it anymore. And it's very similar here in America. When you guys go out to eat, you're probably eating Taiwanese food or Asian food because it's different from, you know, what you can get. You're not eating hamburgers every single day. And so honestly, when my friends and I are out eating in Taiwan, I'm looking for like Korean food, Sichuanese food, I'm looking for like really good brunch or pizza. And in Qingyi district, all the new restaurants that are cool and hip, they're foreign restaurants. And I think maybe to Taiwanese Americans, that's kind of sad. It's like, oh, but like, what about the oyster omelet? But like in Taiwan, we don't want to eat oyster omelet every single time. And a story I really like to tell people is sort of the night market. Like every time there's a journalist and another journalist in Taiwan, they're like, can we like film you at the night market to take us around? And I'm like, can we try something else? Because the night market, the energy has shifted. And that's because of the social economic dynamics of Taiwan today. Back when I was young, when you guys were probably growing up, night markets were, the vendors were one dish specialists, and the mom or the dad had inherited the recipe from the grandma. But like wages are so low, they don't want their kids to do that. There's only probably like one or two night markets where it's still owned by a third generation, fourth generation vendor. The rest is they cook the food in a central kitchen, and then that food is distributed to all the night markets in Taiwan. And you know, so sometimes when I interview people in Asia, they're just like, you know, I know people come and they romanticize, you know, this small eats outside, dirties, but really good food. But they're like, we don't want to live like that. You know, we want the successful restaurants, they get brick and mortars, they expand, they become chains. And so that's where the energy is, and that's what people want to do. So I do see Taipei sort of changing, even Tainan. I'm from like the town where all the street food is, but when I go back, a lot of those stalls that I grew up eating are gone, or they've like become gentrified, or they're like a little bit hip now. And I think when I first moved to Taiwan, I was really upset about this and angry, but now that I'm there, I'm like, you know what, I get it. Like, you don't want to be doing that same thing and earning $2 for your bao. You want to move on, become like the Ding Tai Fung of oyster omelet. So I'm curious what happens when you guys go to Taiwan. Is it very different from when you guys were growing up there?
Yeah, we certainly feel that. I think when we grew up that, so first of all, because the question is about the how class that, so basically it is true that, probably many because I live in Taipei. So I was told that, street food are not that clean. So we should not be doing that every day. So it's fun, but, it's still that this kind of the description already perceives street food is like lower class compared to restaurant. But I think nowadays exactly like Clarissa said that, I feel for the past like 10 to 20 years that, I have seen all the specialized food, which was in the street food in a store form. Now they start to evolve into restaurant. So, I have to say, last December I went back to Taiwan that, I was a little bit disappointed by the night market. Because I found in night market that there are so many new vendors. They are super new. The food was just okay, and then they want to make quick money. And when I was trying to look for like those traditional specialized eats, that some of them are still in a street stand form, but majority of them, so just like you said, Now they already become small brick and mortar.
Actually, Ningxia Night Market, which is one of the few ones where you can get family dishes. I did a story the other day where now they're promoting, you can go into a secret room, like a building, yeah, and then they give you like a banquet of all the night market dishes. They just deliver it to you. And when I was there, like we were the youngest people there. It was like all aunties, like singing karaoke, like...
Really
but it's the night market director who's promoting that. And on another note, this is like people, again, Taiwanese Americans, when we go there, we don't think about it, but climate change is very, very real in Taiwan, and it is just way too hot, even at night, to be out there serving food. Like, it's going to cause a lot of problems with sanitation, and it's just not comfortable. Yeah.
So, Taiwanese food is like comfort food for me, and it reminds me of like my...
Sorry, could you speak up?
So Taiwanese food is like comfort food for me, and it helped me connect it to my roots in a sense. And the question would be like, how does cooking Taiwanese food or researching on Taiwanese food recipe empowers you and influence your Taiwanese identity or Taiwanese American identity?
So the question is, how has researching Taiwanese food helped me with identity or realizing what it means to be Taiwanese? I think just learning the history of it. One thing people always ask me, like, what was the most surprising thing about the book? And it was, like, really figuring out the pantry items, you know? Not like the big sexy dishes, like how to make that, but really figuring out where our pantry items come from. So like black bean soy sauce, which Yunhai sells, plug for Lily, back there. Black bean soy sauce. Taiwan is the only country in the world that still makes soy sauce with black soybeans, and it's a different flavor. It's also gluten-free, and that comes, you know, from our, that it, this is something from the 18th century, but then when the Japanese came, that soy sauce production is now concentrated in one town in Chiluo. And then, but the majority of our soy sauce is made with yellow soybeans, and this is kind of where I got stuck in my research. I was like, okay, so most of our soy sauce is made with yellow soybeans, but how is it different from China? So I actually called up the biggest soy sauce factory in Taiwan, and I was like, how's your soy sauce different? And they were like, I don't know. Like, we just make our soy sauce the way we do it. And then I was just sort of figuring out Japanese style versus Chinese style, and I was like, and I forgot the exact steps, but I read them to them, like the Japanese style. Oh, it's that they use toasted wheat to mix with their soybeans. And I was like, so you guys use toasted wheat, whereas, you know, a lot of places in China use wheat flour. They're like, yeah, I suppose our style is more similar to Japan. And then that just kind of spiraled me down a rabbit hole. Same thing with black vinegar. This was something that I was so confused with as a kid. I was like, why does Taiwanese black vinegar taste so different from Chinese black vinegar? And same thing, I called up the factory. I was like, okay, so how do you make your black vinegar? And then they're like, okay, so we take a rice vinegar and then we steep it with fruits and vegetables. And I was like, so that's very different than, you know, the Chinese is a rice vinegar and then they age it and they're not adding the fruits and vegetables. And then they're like, yeah, we don't do that. That's completely different. So then I was like, these aren't even the same condiments. And then I found like a radio interview that someone did like 10 years ago where they were just like, oh, Taiwanese black vinegar is Japanese Worcester sauce. And I was like, that's really interesting. You know, like the style, Worcester sauce is also an infusion of different, I think they infuse the fish inside, but the infusion is very similar to Taiwanese black vinegar. So figuring out these little details, these things don't exist online, by the way, in English or Chinese. So it was very much me being like, hey, tell me how you're different. And they're like, we don't know how we're different, but we can tell you how it's made. And I think now there's people on the ground trying to learn more about our history. And the reason why Taiwanese people don't know how we're different from China is because we don't go to China. If anything, I felt more connected to China because I'm Taiwanese-American. I'm from the San Gabriel Valley where we have all these Chinese restaurants. So I grew up eating regional Chinese food. But if you ask like anyone in Taiwan, they're like, I don't know, you know, like they can't tell you what like a real Beijing style like pancake should taste like. In fact, you guys probably know better than the average Taiwanese person what Chinese food tastes like. So just figuring out these little details is so fascinating, and I'm constantly discovering new things. Yeah.
So the question is, do you find your favorite recipe from the book for Chef Tony?
Which one is okay?
It's really hard.
Because you when I look this book, I think 80% of the book I already cooked here. So I already own my recipe.
Most Taiwanese people aren't cooking through the book. They're, you know, because it's,
I also meant just sort of like, if you enjoyed that she included that recipe in the book too. It's not necessarily whether you made her exact recipe, but that you
liked
it there.
I really appreciate one is the one dish is fish. You call Wu Liu Zhi,
the herb five willow fish.
Yeah, so her book have this dish, because this dish already is the came from the bakery food. Yeah, so it's really, really old dish. So when I learned this dish, it's from the, I learned from the chef Ah Cai Shi. I learned from a lot, I saw a lot of different version the recipe. Then when I went back to Taiwan, I visit him, and he tell me this history about the Wu Liu Zhi. So I think I'm very happy to see have one of the this dish in on her book, because that's not common on the when you at home when you cooking, not really common cooking this dish at home.
I actually didn't know about that dish until I talked to Ivy, because that dish is in the festival section. So when we were trying to figure out what festive dishes were in it, that's what she suggested.
And actually, why that dish is so important is that so that sauce is very unique in Taiwan. So in a way, so sometimes I even introduce to customer that Wu Liu Zhi, so the five willow fish, the sauce. Is you can argue that's a very Taiwanese version of the sweet and sour. And in Taiwan today, there's so many variations of it, but through that lens that you are able to taste a lot of nuances.
Back there.
Hi, I'm in Taiwan specifically, like I'm drawing some parallels between like the night markets and like the artisanal, like very specific ways in which we make Taiwanese food, the vinegar, the soy sauce, the black and special food mentioned, to some type of like Chinatown labor organizing that happens here. I'll try to be brief, but in like San Francisco Chinatown, labor organizing and has sometimes shuttered like mom and pop restaurants because of labor practices, wage theft, you know, hazards in the workplace. Similarly, in Oakland Chinatown, where I've been organizing storefront workers, and I just like wonder, yeah, does like Taiwan kind of come into a similar problem in wanting to, yeah, like preserve like these traditions that are really important to Taiwanese people? Are there like kind of any like welcoming dome happening in like storefronts in Taiwan? And also, is there any like commercial kind of organizing that's happening? Because I know in like especially in the city centers like Taipei and Kaohsiung, like buying a house is like impossible. Like it's, you know, really expensive, and they definitely have like predatory landlords there too. So super curious about that. I don't know.
I don't know that much about the industry itself, and I know unions are definitely, I don't know, do they exist? I'm looking at my friends who grew up in Taiwan. No, they say no. Yeah, I mean, I have friends who work as chefs and or restaurateurs, and just the wages are very, very low, and you don't give tips there. And the problem with Taiwan is, again, I get, now that I live there, I feel like I see a more holistic picture. Growing up here, I'm like, oh, everything's so cheap there, it's so easy. But I think last year, Taiwan's GDP surpassed Japan for the first time. But the minimum wage is only $1,500 a month. And the reason why is because the top 1%, they hoard all of the wealth. In fact, property prices are on par with like Los Angeles and San Francisco. But like, if with a $1,500 a month salary, you are not able to afford things. So that obviously impacts the food scene. You know, when my friends are hiring for chefs, the wages are low, the hours are really long, and there's just really no protection when it comes to working in the restaurant industry. And so people really aren't incentivized to stay there. And that's a societal-wide problem that you see everywhere, not just in the food industry, but the food industry is especially tough. And so that's why it's so cool to come to America. I know I sound like a middle school teacher, but it's cool because people are very entrepreneurial. You're starting new things. It's all about fair labor practices and, you know, giving people what they're due. But in Taiwan, it's really hard to be an entrepreneur. There's not, you know, there aren't, you don't have that type of organizing like you guys, we see here in America, and that really impacts the food scene at the end of the day. A lot of the creativity is coming, I think, from the fine dining scene, but that's a very specific type of food for a very specific type of clientele. Or there are affluent Taiwanese-Americans going over and opening restaurants, but it's really difficult to see, you know, like a young Taiwanese person opening a cool restaurant. And if they do, honestly, it's in the south, and it's like they're opening in their like grandma's house or their mom's house. You know, you rarely see it in Taipei, and that's something I'm a little bit sad about. When I'm in Taiwan, I wish there was more energy, and every time I'm in America, I'm like, this is, you know, being in America is really cool. We can start new concepts and try different things, and we just don't have that energy right now in Taiwan.
Any other questions?
Yes. So I have questions on, like, so as a Taiwanese-American, and also this question for Chef Tony, is that when there's so many, even on the same dish, there's just so many different kind of food from north to south, like Rufa has a different flavor in north, south, and middle. As a book writer, how do you pick one that, do you think that, okay, that is a Taiwanese food, that's the flavor that I want to put in this book, or is Chef Tony, like, how do I pick, like, a region of that flavor, of, let's say, Rufa, to identify, or to tell people that that is the flavor that I want to pass? Like, how do you define, how do you pick that?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. For me, it's really easy. Me and my co-author are both from China in the South, so we just went with whatever version was familiar with us. And then if we have conflicting versions, so for example, the Ba Wan, the crystal meatball, I'm from the city of Tainan, she's from the countryside of Tainan, so the wrapper is a little bit different, and she just sort of defaulted to me. She was like, which restaurant do you go to? And I like gave her the Google pin, and she'll go and like try it. So you know, if I was to really do a super comprehensive book with all the variations of Ba Wan, that's a whole other, like, my advance was not high enough to cover that. And the thing also with regional Taiwanese food in Taiwan now is that ever since the high speed rail open, it's just, I can go down to Tainan in 2 hours. You know, everything is becoming mushed together. Those regional variants aren't as apparent as it was when I was a kid. And so you really just have to go with what you know and what you grew up with.
I think it's similar, because I grew up in Taichung, so I eat a lot of lofan in Taichung. And then for sure, when I go to the Taipei, I try the Taipei lofan. It's so different. Okay. So I just cook in the flavors that I really love. And then, yes, for the Tainan, the lu lo fan, I love Tainan lu lo fan, the texture. But Tainan lu lo fan more sweet. Yeah. So when I decided to measure my recipe, first, this recipe, when I testing, I test it the home. Okay. Second, this recipe, I add the sugar cane, fresh sugar cane. This one is Tainan. When they cook in the lulo fan, they will add the sugar cane in. But I love the sugar cane, the sweetness, right? So like I said, I really love the use the original ingredient, bring the sweetness come out. So I add the fresh sugar cane. If the sugar cane is seasoned, I will add the sugar cane in my lulo fan. So when you taste the sweetness, have a different layer, different, including the aroma, so different. So my lulo fan have three different sugar. So I try to design the lulo fan for the is I really love first. I really love that, and then I think that tastes really good. So this is why I can share to everyone. So all the food for me, yes. All the food is Tony love. And then Tony like it. If Tony don't like it, she will not cook it for you.
All right. Any other questions?
Yes, we're talking about that, and then, but I think it's really hard to pick one, because Taiwanese food is a lot of face you can say, and so we're talking about the cook, Susan,
the publisher,
so we're talking about now, and then brainstorming the thinking, what kind of cookbook we want to share. Yeah, so not yet, but we're working on, I put out my mind, and then to thinking about what kind of story I want to say, and then what kind of recipe I want to share. Yeah.
Thank you. All right, anyone else?
Okay, so I also wanted to
Yeah, so I guess it's official now, so I'll tell you guys. I'm working on a postpartum book. When I just gave birth 8 months ago, and I checked into a postpartum hotel, and I was just served all of these foods, and all my friends in the States, they were like, I want to learn how to make it, or how do I get this? And unfortunately, you guys don't have that here, or you can do like some services. Taiwan's really interesting. We have the largest postpartum industry per capita in the entire world, but also like the lowest birth rate in the world. But it's been a 3-decade-long industry. And I think a lot of women, when we give birth, we don't actually know what we want, but we know the vibes. You know we want sesame oil, we know we want rice wine, and then we're just kind of stuck. And Taiwan has managed to update this for the modern mom. Sometimes when I tell my friends I wanted to write this book, they're like, oh, that's nasty. I don't want to eat the Chinese medicine. But what was interesting at the postpartum hotel, which, by the way, if people don't know, in Taiwan, after you give birth, you can check into a luxury hotel where they take care of your baby and give you massages and 3 meals delivered a day. What was interesting about this hotel is that the food is actually really light now. It's not a lot of Chinese medicine. It's like going and getting chicken noodle soup, and they'll have all like the good herbs for you, but it's not overwhelming. So that's my project that I'm working on now.
Woohoo! All right. I don't want to keep you folks out here for too long. It's getting a little chilly, and I want to just take this opportunity and thank you, Clarissa, one more time for. Forward to a book like this to really help them connect to the roots and to help them understand Taiwanese food more. So let's hear one more time for our wonderful panelists.
Can I like take a video of you guys holding up the book? I'm really bad at social media, but I should do this. So I'll just take a video and say three, and you guys like look excited with the book. Oh yeah, if you can do it. Yeah. Okay. I'll do a selfie. I only know how to do selfie.
Yeah.
Okay. One,
two, three. Woo! Yay! Woo!
So we'll back to the indoor, and then we'll start to do book signing. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.